Profile Audio presents The Border, The Legacy of a Century of Anglo-Irish Politics, by Diarmaid Ferriter, and read by Aidan. Chapter 1. The Long Gestation. The island of Ireland was partitioned in 1920, partly due to a combination of British duplicity, the insecurities, fears, and desires of Ulster Unionists, and the delusions and dashed hopes of Southern Irish Republicans, and partly because the likely alternative to a border was civil war. In subsequent decades, the border was cemented by aggressive political ideology, economic policy, and harrowing violence before its potency was tempered by a peace process and economic and political pragmatism. Its future, since the British electorate voted to leave the EU in June 2016, has been under a focus not witnessed in decades, as it is the UK's only land border with another European country. Ideological partition was long a reality in Ireland before the physical border was imposed, owing to the distinctive development of Ulster, the most northern of the four historic Irish provinces, comprising 9 of the island's 32 counties and amounting to roughly 8,950 square miles, just over a quarter of the island of Ireland's total area. Until the 17th century, Ulster was isolated as a part of a Gaelic Ireland that had been more resistant than the three other Irish provinces to Norman and English rule since the 12th century. The vast social engineering of the 17th century, however, resulted in the seizure of property and the removal of people on the basis of their religion, making the province a bastion of Protestant settlement and British influence. Plantation resulted in the seizure from Catholic natives of 5,600 square miles in Ulster, transforming the province with the arrival of English and Scottish settlers, who differed in terms of religious affiliation, the English belonging to the established Anglican Church and the Scots Presbyterian, but had a common bond of Britishness, a term novel at that stage and one especially applied to those engaged in colonial endeavour. But full British control of Ulster was not achieved. While there was some assimilation and accommodation between these settlers and the Catholic natives, any possibility of permanent harmony was shattered by the Ulster Rebellion of 1641, spearheaded by Catholics who retained land and status, with Ireland for the next 10 years a theatre of war in the War of the Three Kingdoms, and for the 10 years after that she found herself a laboratory for Cromwellian experiments. This included atrocities on a grand scale with the killing of soldiers, civilians, and Catholic clergy. With the restoration of monarchy in 1660, there were hopes for a Catholic resurgence that were scuppered at the battles of the Boyne, 1690, and Ockram, 1691, which confirmed Protestant dominance. Presbyterians were also excluded from the fruits of victory, but the Catholic question reignited in the late 18th century and rebellion in 1798 by a combination of radical Catholics and Protestants seeking the removal of English influence in Ireland stoked further enmities and fears about the stability of the Anglo-Irish connection. In response, the Act of Union was passed in 1800, creating the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland, and providing that Ireland be represented at Westminster by 100 MPs. Over the course of the 19th century, increasing Catholic and nationalist confidence and demands were manifest in Southern Ireland. By 1861, just 8.9% of the population of the three southern provinces was Protestant, while the figure in Ulster was 49.5%, a figure that steadily increased to 55.8% by 1901. The industrialisation of Belfast and the Lagan Valley in the 19th century also set it apart from a country that was overwhelmingly agrarian. There was consensus that Belfast, as it thrived and expanded, was more British, and that Ulster was different from the rest of Ireland. By 1886, the British Prime Minister, William Gladstone, had decided home rule for Ireland was feasible and convenient from both the British and Irish perspectives. By then, iconic nationalist leader Charles Stuart Parnell had built a formidable Irish Parliamentary Party, IPP, demanding Irish self-government within the empire, and was now a key player in British as well as Irish politics. Unionists, however, island-wide, were determined to resist this in defence of unity of the UK. And so began a four-decade struggle that ended in partition. Gladstone did not succeed with his Home Rule Bills of 1886 and 1893, but Home Rule demands continued. Irish nationalist MPs, somewhat adrift after the death of Parnell in 1891, but reunified under the leadership of John Redmond in 1900, continued to remain a thorn in the side of the British political establishment, and the IPP held the balance of power in Westminster by 1910. By 1912, following an alliance between the British Liberal Party and Irish Nationalists against the wishes of Conservatives and Unionists, and helped by the eradication of the House of Lords veto on legislation from the House of Commons, Home Rule was a distinct likelihood without any solution to Unionist resistance, now being spearheaded by Dublin-born lawyer Edward Carson, leader of the Ulster Unionist Party from 1910. Prime Minister Herbert Asquith, lacking real conviction about the merits of Home Rule but in debt to the IPP for their support of reform of the House of Lords, duly introduced the third Home Rule Bill in April 1912, declaring it would give Ireland ample scope for the development of its own national life, while binding Ireland to the Empire through a sense of voluntary cooperation. This became the Home Rule Act in September 1914. Asquith, however, underestimated the gravity of the Ulster problem. During this period, the increasing Ulsterisation of the Unionist focus was hardened by the militancy of the Loyal Orange Institution, or the Orange Order, the Protestant defensive alliance with the greatest longevity, dating back to 1795, and now with a new lease of life. It was deemed pragmatic by Unionists to defend the area where they were more numerous than to attempt to sustain an all-Ireland opposition to Irish nationalist aspirations. Greater defiance included the signing of a covenant, a pact with God, in 1912, pledging to use all means necessary to defeat the present conspiracy to set up a Home Rule Parliament in Ireland, and the creation of an Ulster volunteer force in 1913 to resist by force of arms Home Rule being implemented. This was blatant rebellion, and it was tolerated by British authorities in a manner that did not extend to Irish nationalists pledged through their own Irish volunteer organisation to fight for Home Rule's imposition. Leading Conservative politicians, including party leader Andrew Bonar Law, who had an Ulster Presbyterian background and who led opposition to the government from 1911 to 1915, backed the Ulster opposition to Home Rule, joining 70 other Conservative MPs at a Unionist demonstration in Balmoral in 1912. There were, as a result of this polarisation, two minority issues in Ireland: the status of nationalists in Ulster and the position of Unionists in Ireland as a whole, and religion was central to their politics. The Irish Unionist Alliance in 1907 had stoked fears of Catholic domination in Ireland by insisting Home Rule would mean Rome Rule. The people of Ulster are largely Protestant. They believe, and who are capable of judging better, that a home-ruled Ireland would be an Ireland mainly dominated by the ideas of the Irish Roman Catholic hierarchy and clergy, who claim authority as much in temporal or secular affairs as they do in matters religious or spiritual. But it would be a mistake to see Ulster Protestant identity as axiomatically a British one. As historian Oliver McDonough saw it, Ulster for Northern Protestants was more than a province, less than a state. It constituted at least a people. Many Unionist activists came to see themselves as Ulster people, not Britons. Partition became a reality on the back of extraordinary upheavals in the decade after 1912, not least the First World War, during which over 200,000 Irishmen, Unionist and Nationalist, served in the British Army. The implementation of Home Rule was postponed for the duration of the war without any solution to the Ulster crisis. In the spring of 1914, John Redmond reluctantly agreed to individual Ulster counties opting out of Home Rule for 6 years, a period rejected by Edward Carson, who characterised it as a sentence of death with a stay of execution. The war effort was backed by Redmond and his constitutional nationalists, as well as by Ulster Unionists, who suffered catastrophic losses, in particular at the Battle of the Somme in July 1916. Overall, some 40,000 Irishmen lost their lives in the war. The longer the war endured, the more emboldened a minority of radical separatists in Ireland became, leading to the April 1916 Rising, during which an Irish Republic was declared in Dublin, further increasing the ideological gulf between Ulster and the South. In its wake, Sinn Féin, meaning ourselves, a political movement established in 1905, capitalised on the transformation in public opinion in Southern Ireland after Britain executed the leaders of the rebellion and interned almost 2,000 suspected of involvement. Under the leadership of Éamon de Valera, a surviving commandant of the Easter Rising, and his deputy president Arthur Griffith, the original founder of Sinn Féin, the party triumphed in the 1918 general election and decimated the IPP. A war of independence between Crown forces and the Irish Republican Army, which had evolved from the Irish Volunteer Organisation, followed. While the Irish Civil War raged from 1922 to 1923 as the Irish Republican movement was ripped apart by the fallout from the signing of the Anglo-Irish Treaty between Irish Republicans and the British government in December 1921, that created a free state in Southern Ireland, a dominion of the British Empire. Crucially, the British government did not negotiate with Irish Republicans until it had first addressed the Ulster question. Partition had been suggested as a solution to the Home Rule problem by Liberal MP Thomas Agar Robarts in June 1912, the idea being centred on the exclusion from Home Rule of four Ulster counties, Antrim, Down, Armagh and Derry. Agar Robarts received support from some unionists, essentially because of their distrust not only of Irish nationalists, but also of Southern Unionists and British Liberals and Tories. Partition was ultimately about the triumph of localism and all the narrow-mindedness that went with that. While Edward Carson, who led the Unionist parliamentarians until 1921, was of the view that Ireland was an indivisible unit, by 1916 he and the Ulster Unionist Council, the umbrella body designed from 1905 to unite various Unionist organisations and bind Unionist MPs to their constituents, accepted the principle of the exclusion of six counties of Ulster, Fermanagh and Tyrone added to the original four above, because if full union could not be maintained, this was deemed the best alternative. That year was also a crucial one for nationalists in Ulster, as their 1916 conference in Belfast sparked a stinging conflict between Home Rulers and Sinn Féin. Set up by Joe Devlin, a key organiser and IPP MP for Ulster Nationalists, and addressed by John Redmond, the Ulster Nationalist Conference voted to accept a proposal for temporary exclusion of the six northeastern counties as the price for the early implementation of Home Rule. But there was a clear geographical divide. Delegates from Fermanagh, Tyrone and Derry City, mid-Ulster, voted firmly against this proposal. Carson was still privately open to the idea of an alternative, and in March 1917 prepared a plan to tempt Ulster into devolved Irish government, whereby Ulster would be left out of Home Rule, but an All-Ireland Council with representatives of a Home Rule Parliament and Ulster MPs at Westminster would consider legislative proposals for the whole of Ireland and frame a procedure by which, if agreement was reached, they could be enacted simultaneously in Dublin and the excluded counties. The British government was open to this, and Carson was willing to try to sell it to his party, but it was shelved in favour of the Irish Convention that lasted from July 1917 to April 1918. This was a doomed attempt to negotiate a settlement between nationalists and unionists, devised by David Lloyd George, British Prime Minister since December 1916, largely for the optics and as a response to American pressure. Lloyd George, and before him Herbert Asquith, were more preoccupied with how the Irish question would affect their own party and British politics than its potential impact on Ireland, which was too often a pawn in the game of their career advancement. There were serious consequences for Ireland as a result. The triumph of Sinn Féin in the December 1918 election, winning 73 seats on an abstention from Westminster platform, and with a demand for a 32-county Irish Republic, further polarised Ireland. With the First World War now over, the Irish question had to be confronted once more. Unionists were helped by the presence at Cabinet of Walter Long, who had led the Irish Unionists between 1906 and 1910, and now headed the Cabinet Committee on Irish Affairs. Details of a partition plan were gradually worked out, and though there was some sympathy at government level for the Nationalists, the only Irishmen to be consulted were James Craig and his associates. Craig, a principal architect of opposition to the Third Home Rule Bill, was also serving in a government position, and took over from the declining Carson as Ulster Unionist leader in early 1921. But it was Walter Long who, from 1919, had most influence over the British cabinet. And what was decided under his direction was that it was not enough to repeal the 1914 Home Rule Act. What was needed was unity of empire, therefore no Irish Republic. No coercion of Ulster, a parliament for Southern Ireland, another for Ulster if it so chose, and a Council of Ireland as a means of enabling Ireland to work out her own salvation. It was envisaged that the new act would ultimately lead to Irish unity, but if the two parliaments could not agree to come together, they could stay in isolation. There would be no forcing of Ulster to join the South, but neither was there an assumption Ulster would remain a fully integrated part of the UK. It was clear that partition was being imposed by Britain, but, as Ronan Fanning characterised it, the ending of partition would be a matter for the Irish. What was attractive for Long's committee was the possibility of the complete withdrawal of British rule from all of Ireland in all matters not especially reserved, as its presence had been the taproot of the Irish difficulty. While the British preference was for a 9-county Ulster solution, Craig preferred 6 because Antrim, Armagh, Down, Fermanagh, Derry and Tyrone comprised the largest area where there was a decisive Protestant majority in which Unionist power could be guaranteed in perpetuity. Ronan Fanning, in Dissecting Cabinet Discussions of 1919, notes that Ulster centricity was paramount. It was known that Sinn Féin would reject these proposals. As Lord Chancellor F.E. Smith saw it, the bill was about not coming to terms with Irish Republicans, but the strengthening of our tactical position before the world. But there was also no doubt that Long's initiative, with the backing of Lloyd George, keen to placate US opinion, was also about some dilution of the Union. As Carson commented acidly in December 1919 about the government's attitude towards Unionists, "You still want to kick them out as if they were of no use." The Cabinet had been told the previous month that Ulster Unionists would not be on the same footing as citizens of Great Britain, but subject to a different regime. What transpired was the Government of Ireland Act, sometimes known as the Partition Act. It provided for separate parliaments for 6 Ulster counties and Southern Ireland, and though rejected by Sinn Féin, it provided the constitutional framework for the creation of Northern Ireland, of which James Craig became the first Prime Minister in 1921. The Act was also a reflection of the growing determination of British politicians to get the Irish question off its tables. The Tories no longer needed or wanted to rally around Unionists, and Liberals were no longer courting Irish votes. As Philip Kerr, an advisor to David Lloyd George, wrote, "It would at least accomplish 2 essential things. It would take Ulster out of the Irish question, which it had blocked for a generation, and it would take Ireland out of English party controversies." That was the privately acknowledged reality, and did not suggest any sense of an Ulster Unionism being valued or cherished by the British political establishment. 13 Irish MPs would continue to represent Northern Ireland at Westminster. Northern Ireland, with a population of roughly 1.6 million, 430,000 of whom were Catholic, was and remained an expensive nuisance. At the outset of its existence, 4/5 of the Belfast government's revenue came from London. What the new border meant in physical terms was that county lines that had been established in the 16th and 17th centuries were adhered to regardless of what they crossed. County boundaries had often run along rivers, which later attracted urban settlements, so the hinterlands of a number of towns were now split, and even individual farms and houses were divided by the border. Quite simply, the partition line was arbitrary. Using county borders also meant that many nationalists and unionists were left on the wrong side, and it inevitably ruptured communities. Clerical administrative units would also cross the border, and the Catholic primate of all Ireland was and remained based in Armagh. The new border's physical manifestations were ridiculous. T.W. Freeman, a pioneer of geographical studies in Ireland, published his book Ireland in 1950 and noted, "No clear boundary exists, for County Armagh meets Monaghan in what is generally a farmed landscape." Or as economic historian D.S. Johnson later put it, "Like the equator, the border is an invisible line." As was apparent from the first Ordnance Survey of Northern Ireland in 1938, it was blessed with one of the densest rural road networks, in terms of population, if not area, in Western Europe. No less than 180 roads crossed the border, and in some 35 to 40 instances, they defined it, with the frontier lying in the middle and a crossing point every mile. But only a fraction of these, 16, were approved border roads from the 1920s. In one case that came to light in 1937, a house in Fermanagh was divided by the border, and a Catholic registration association unsuccessfully attempted to disenfranchise four Protestants on the grounds that they slept in a part of the house that was in a foreign country, the Irish Free State, though the kitchen and sitting room were in Northern Ireland. Was this partition a British construct? That was certainly the central plank of subsequent nationalist narratives. As David O'Neill saw it in The Partition of Ireland, 1949, it was an outrage that was committed upon Ireland by British politicians in pursuant of their own party politics. Dennis Gwynne argued in his History of Partition the following year, his father Stephen had been an MP and strong defender of John Redmond, "Lloyd George's record in the whole story of partition shows a completely opportunist attitude." Frank Gallagher's The Indivisible Island, 1957, continued this focus, with Ireland depicted as a pawn in a British party game and a victim of a powerful empire. That was only part of the story, however, and partition was born with the assistance of Irish midwives also, unionist and nationalist. Despite Craig's assertion that it was a supreme sacrifice for unionists, who were now abandoning southern unionists, in 1911 there were 327,179 Protestants in Southern Ireland, where the overall population was about 2.8 million. As far back as 1910, he had asserted, "Perhaps we should change our tactics. It strikes me that a great deal of the energy and money would be much better expended by just letting Ulster take her own firm stand." His brother Charles Craig, Unionist MP for South Antrim, offered another reason by telling the House of Commons in March 1920 that Unionists now wanted their own Parliament because a profound mistrust of the Labour Party and of the Liberal leader Asquith made Unionists believe that if either of those parties were in power again, Unionist chances of remaining in the UK would be very small. Fred Crawford, a key figure on the secret military committee of the Ulster Unionist Council, asserted, "I consider that by voting for the six counties, I have kept my 1912 covenant both in spirit and letter. My objective in signing the covenant was to keep Ulster Protestant and free from any possibility of becoming a part of a Home Rule Ireland with one parliament in Dublin." And there, laid bare, was the sectarian reality. To keep Ulster Protestant was the bedrock on which Ulster Unionists built their acceptance of partition. Of 52 MPs in the Northern Ireland House of Commons elected in May 1921, 40 were Unionist, and Nationalists and Republicans divided the remaining spoils, establishing the pattern that endured. Sectarian violence also marred the state's birth. Between July 1920 and July 1922, there were 557 people killed, 303 Catholics, 172 Protestants, and 82 members of the police and British forces. The 1920 bill did not solve the Irish crisis. Sinn Féin rejected it, and was by then conducting a political war of independence and building a republican state to try to supplant the British administration in Ireland, while the IRA waged a parallel military war of independence. The cessation of violence in July 1921 was followed by negotiations between Sinn Féin and the government led by David Lloyd George, which led to a new chapter in the Irish border saga. Éamon de Valera refused to lead the Irish delegation and remained in Dublin, while Arthur Griffith embraced the task. Lloyd George was seen by some as one who betrayed his sympathy for the South in the face of what Griffith, in London from October to December 1921, referred to bitingly as the cloven hoof of Ulster's sordidness. Griffith was ultimately to become impaled on the Ulster cross, though he also hammered more nails into it than were necessary. The British were determined to avoid a collapse of the talks over Ulster, where, as Lloyd George admitted, they had a weaker case owing to the political and economic consequences of dividing such a small country, than on the question of Ireland staying in the Empire. In September 1921, Lloyd George had been privately adamant that, while British soldiers might die for the throne and empire, "I do not know who will die for Tyrone and Fermanagh. The feeling here is not so strong as in 1913-14. Lots feel a bit annoyed about Ulster, think them unreasonable, narrow." The Irish delegates insisted on local plebiscites as a way to determine the contested border, but were prepared to allow Northern Ireland to retain its existing territory, parliament, and government if the Unionists would agree to these being subordinate to Dublin and not London, or what was regarded as essential unity, which the Unionists emphatically rejected. Lloyd George found James Craig reasonable in November 1921. He discussed conditions under which an All-Ireland Parliament would function, but when he came again on Monday afternoon, he had changed. Under no circumstances could Ulster look at an All-Ireland Parliament. To which Lloyd George responded, "We will not force. A boundary commission is a defensible position." While Craig refused to be blinkered by the charm and chancing of the Prime Minister, Lloyd George pushed this boundary commission idea to determine the Irish border, a commission that would supposedly examine the distribution of population along the border of the six counties to ascertain which side they should be or wished to be on. The Cabinet had been told in late 1919 that James Craig had privately suggested such an initiative. Griffith responded by insisting the division of Ireland was unnatural. "What you have done is as if some few counties in England had been separated from the rest," and he maintained naively that if the Ulster Unionists did not have the backing of the British government, we could settle the Ulster question. He also suggested Unionists had their own distinctive identity, remarking that there were two ways to annoy a working-class Unionist. One was to speak respectfully of the Pope, the other was to call him an Englishman. Lloyd George was also happy to elaborate on the Unionists' psychology. "They are a pugnacious people with a touch of the Scotch about them, which is a very stubborn race. We are only behind them to the extent that we cannot allow civil war to take place at our doors, which will embroil our own people. There is nothing we would like better than that they would unite with you. We stand neutral." This highly qualified commitment to Ulster's Unionists remained relevant in subsequent decades. Griffith, however, was ultimately and too easily steamrolled by Lloyd George into a private agreement that he would not repudiate a plan for a boundary commission and compromised Lloyd George's position with his Conservative and Unionist critics. The crucial point was that Griffith was encouraged to believe that the boundary commission would transfer significant areas of Northern Ireland to the proposed new dominion in the 26 counties of Southern Ireland, what became the Irish Free State, and after 1949, the Irish Republic. As Griffith saw it, according to Lloyd George's secretary, Tom Jones, We would prefer a plebiscite, but in essentials, a boundary commission is very much the same. It certainly was not. There were a number of Lloyd Georges on display during these talks. He gave various impressions as to what he would do about Ulster obduracy, including apparently threatening to resign. It is ironic, indeed, that it was James Craig who, when he met Eamon de Valera in 1921, warned him never to meet Lloyd George alone, as he would give any account of the interview that suited him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.